Well, I'd like to welcome you, and I'm Monika Feeney, Program Director of the School of Anesthesia currently, and we're in the O'Reilly Health Sciences Building, and it is November 9th, 2016, and this is the first in the series of the Oral History of MSU School of Anesthesia. And right now we are lucky to have with us Donna Murney, one of our graduates. So, the reason I think that I decided to be program director was because of our alumni. And I love the stories of anesthesia of a long time ago, like before my time. And I just didn't want to let that go. I didn't want that to not be anymore. And the, like the things in our museum, that's what made me excited, the history of it. And so I thought, well, I better get these stories written down or I won't remember them because I'm not going to stay here forever either, you know, and I want our students to know about it and to know, you know, what we've come through and what we've done.
MSU played a significant role in the what I call the birth of modern anesthesia.
Yeah. So, well, anyway, so that's the whole goal of what we're doing.
Right.
So thank you for coming today.
Well, I commend the goal. I think it's very important to have an archive of our history.
Yeah.
It's very important.
Awesome. Well, and the one of the main things is I want you to tell us the history of the seal.
Okay. Well, that's a good place to start right there.
I don't know if you can, there. Yes. We can put this in our... So it says SMSA and Santa Claus comes to PAS December 14th, 1972.
Okay, so... So the setting was that too was a presidential election year.
Mm-hmm.
We had just been through that. And the doctors were in the process of incorporating to become PAS.
Mm-hmm.
So all of those things were happening at the same time. Plus, that it was the tradition that students sort of showed their appreciation to the doctors for the nice evening, the nice party, by having a short program.
Mm-hmm.
It was usually accompanied by fun gifts,
mm-hmm.
but by skits or by some means of entertaining the doctors during the party. And the party was originally given by the doctors because the students didn't have enough money to take their spouses or their boyfriends or girlfriends out on the town for a nice meal and a dance.
Mm-hmm.
So they said, okay, we can at least do this for them.
Mm-hmm.
It was also the tradition that as many doctors as possible would come,
uh-huh.
but always Dr. Tillman would stay back to, quote, mind the store.
Uh-huh. So he'd stay in the hospital.
And we never were quite sure if this was out of altruism or he just didn't want to be there with us.
Okay.
But whatever the reason, the other doctors appreciated. And, of course, as time went on, there couldn't be just one doctor left behind.
Mm-hmm.
So this particular time, I think we had seven doctors. And I can remember as a student coming into the classroom after, or the workroom actually,
mm-hmm.
after a morning of diverse cases with several different physicians supervising, writing on the board, there are at least seven ways to skin a cat. So we soon learned that was part of the deal. You could be doing the same kind of a procedure with the same kind of surgeon, but it depended on who your anesthesiologist was, how you should set up the case and how it would proceed.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that aside.
Still today.
Yes. Still today. So if you look carefully at the names printed under here, it will show you the name of each student who was part of planning the Christmas party, who was enrolled at that particular time. And then here are the physicians lined up as the seven,
dwarfs. Oh, that's amazing. Yes. Yeah.
So you all of this, as I look back, I would consider it a manic phase because we were all of this was happening, Some of us had families, children. It was like Christmas season, all of this, plus many of us winding down our studies.
Yes.
So all of this was happening at once. We were still working a regular schedule, call, etc. So these were all extracurricular hours that we were spending getting
doing
this
these
together.
Things together. Yeah.
So we would have planning meetings, and in order to get the seal together, you know, it took several different trips to these different venues, mm-hmm. including from St. John's over to Cox to collaborate with the other. So it was quite a project, but certainly well worth it. And it's just amazing that it has survived this long. I was trying to think what that was adhered to, but it is a surviving memento.
Yes, that's amazing. And so we made the big one.
Yes.
So,
and it's wonderful.
And we did get permission when we transitioned over to Missouri State to keep that as our emblem, and so as our symbol. They gave us permission. That was part of the deal for us to come over.
That was very good.
So
that was very good.
And so describe it for us. So tell us what all the parts mean.
Okay. Well, again, referring back to the idea of a presidential election year, focus on our country, and we looked at the symbols, the seal of the United States. And I probably need one here again to look at, but then we superinscribed, or we parodied, or we somehow reinterpreted those symbols in view of anesthesia student life.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of an eagle, we now have a buzzard, and I have to give a nod to Bill Kirk for that.
Okay.
When I had first put out these different symbols and thought and said, now this is something that we could use, and then we'll change it a little bit to match our needs, well, he immediately said, we're not this, we cannot be this majestic
eagle,
silent, wise. Let's bring it up to date and down to our level. So he immediately thought we had to have the vulture, the buzzard. So, and we see the shield there on the front of what is now our bird.
Mm-hmm.
And we see, of course, the endotracheal tubes, the syringe of pentothal, the banner up here, the illegitimi non corporundum, the seven faces of the doctors. Well, if you look at the presidential seal, you will see some type of these same replications. We wanted to be sure that Mercy, or St. John's,
uh-huh.
was represented. We
uh-huh.
wanted to be sure that the Florence Nightingale lamp was uh-huh. represented. We wanted the physician's caduceus to be there.
Mm-hmm.
We wanted to give some proclamation to the seven physicians who were there to become the first corporation, and we wanted to have a motto that, as it turns out, Bill thought would best reflect the interaction of physicians, surgeons, anesthesiologists, anesthetists. So that is how we got the illegitimi motto.
Now, was Bill a student then, or was he?
No, he was our school co-director.
Okay.
And I was the last student he agreed to be the mother for.
Oh.
He's then.
Yes. Yeah. That's funny.
Yes, that was quite a challenge for both of us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But certainly he was so very well qualified. He had done his time in Vietnam.
Yeah.
He had a wonderful service record. He was forever dedicated to all of the soldiers that he took care of.
Mm-hmm.
He never forgot the ones that he couldn't bring back with
right.
the
right.
surgeon's help, etc. afterward.
Right.
And he promised them that he said, you won't be forgotten.
Right. And I've kept that promise for him too. Excellent. So each of the students, they get to watch the video of him mm-hmm. telling the story. Yes. And I used to have him come and share yes. it. And he did it a few times for me.
Right.
And I talked to him just a couple months ago. And he yeah. wasn't sure. Couldn't but I have it. Two videos of him telling it. Oh, and I promised him that would always continue.
Okay.
Also.
Well, that was a very wise move on your part.
So
very good. So are there any other aspects on here that I failed to mention? That, oh, I know, this wonderful band around them.
Yes.
We thought, oh, that's where we can put in our sleep mode. So we did that. Got Z's all the way around.
And so all the students were involved in deciding that seal. Is that right? Or
well, everyone had to pass their approval on it.
Gotcha. Yes.
It was...
Who drew it? Because that's a really good buzzard.
Well, that's a good question. What we did was to take all these different parts and symbols
uh-huh.
with us
uh-huh.
down to the sign company downtown.
Mm-hmm.
I had known the father who had run this sign company, and I told him what we were trying to do, and he said, "A what?"
And yes, yeah.
From your school.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
So then we brought in his son. We brought in his son,
uh-huh.
and we said, "This is what we're trying to do, and we know what we want, kind of what we want it to look like,
right.
but we need an artistic input
yes, yes.
to get it all together uh-huh. and to make it possible to put it all on a seal."
Right.
So we talked to him for quite a bit, and I'll have to keep trying to do research. I don't think we put his name on the back,
uh-huh, uh-huh.
but the company was still there for a long time, but now yes. they have gone
yeah.
away from downtown. So, but it was in the end put together by professionals
uh-huh.
in the sense that they did this for a living.
Uh-huh.
They'd never seen anything quite like this,
right.
but they were willing to
give it a try.
Shot. And,
yes.
and so we were pleased
mm-hmm.
that they would join us in the project.
That's amazing. And, you know, we get the most comments on it, and the students love it. They want it on everything that they have, their T-shirts and their sweatshirts and all. And so it's, and we have it on all of our letterheads now, along with the MSU Bear, both. Although we're not really supposed to have the MSU Bear. We're supposed to have the Carrington instead.
Oh, okay.
Because we're an academic program, and the Bear is for sports.
Yes.
However, most people in the community don't recognize what that is, and
yes.
so we put the Bear most
yes.
of the time. So
that's a good point. That's a good point. Well,
So tell me too, the like when you were in school, how many students were there at a time, or how many were, like that was all of them? Okay.
You've got our names on the back.
Of that, yes, yes.
So yes, that would have been both classes.
And so school was 2 years? Is that how long it took
yes.
then? 2 years?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Oh, show us your lab coat.
I remember the first day I came to school, which was April the 1st,
uh-huh.
and I thought, I know I'm going to get there, and they're going to say, just kidding.
uh-huh.
Because I had just finished boards.
Nursing boards? Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. I had not had any experience. I had not gotten to work in, you know.
Yeah.
So I was always kind of like, am I really going to go to anesthesia school? Is this
right.
really okay?
Right.
But they needed someone. You know
yes.
how it is.
Yes.
There was an alternate who dropped out,
uh-huh.
and Dr. Wise saw me in the hall one day and said, well, would you like to come into anesthesia school? We have an opening.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, little did I know how important it was to the call schedule
right.
that you fill those. But I was at the point where I needed to choose between pediatric
mm-hmm.
specialist
mm-hmm.
With one of the groups who had
uh-huh.
asked me to come with them,
uh-huh.
or working at the hospital,
uh-huh.
or going. So it was decided, well, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Take this opportunity, because it was obviously something way beyond what I could have planned. So that's how it got to be. So that April the 1st when I went in, and Dr. Crawford was teaching that section, and I remember at the end of class, I asked him if I could have a copy of the syllabus.
Yeah.
Because it was a 2-year program, and here I was coming in April.
Yes.
And all these people had already been there, and I thought, I'll just look at the syllabus and I'll see what I've missed, and then I can catch up and hopefully.
Yeah.
And he said, a what? Uh-huh. And I said, you know, a syllabus that shows the program for what's
happening.
And well, if you'll just come to class every morning and be here for 2 years, you'll know what's going on. So anyway, of course, I had planned to go to class every morning, and we did that.
Like at what time?
Six. Mm-hmm. Yeah, six. And if you've been at work at Cox the night before, you would have to come over, leaving there, you know, 5-ish, come to class, go back to your morning routine.
Mm-hmm. And so you did clinical time both at St. John's and at Cox, depending on where.
I know, and there were some hard days, because sometimes you would have done labor and delivery all night, come to class, go back to work until you relieved someone for lunch, and you yourself would not have had
lunch,
dinner, or breakfast, or lunch.
But
that was part of it.
Yeah.
You know, you were in quote boot camp for anesthesia, so you just bit the bullet and did your share. And of course, that was whoever relieved you the next day might have been in the same boat.
Right. Now, how did you even know about anesthesia from nursing school? Because you went to a diploma program, right, at St. John's?
Yes, I got into that because I was kind of on maternity leave from working. Mm-hmm. I had done some work at Missouri State, SMS. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I was on maternity leave and had the opportunity to tutor student nurses to pass.
Their boards and stuff?
Yes, there's been a little bit of leaning in the wrong direction, according to the sisters at the school. And so they asked me if I could, quote, tutor or help. And so I enrolled with them in the microbiology class and the chemistry class and went back to those classes at Missouri State. It was SMS. And then would try to meet with the students, and we would go over it together and take our tests and review them and see what we could do better. Anyway, we finished the semester, and I remember going home thinking, I hope they all pass. And no one ever called me to say we passed or we didn't or whatever. It was only like a year later when I saw they said, oh yeah, we did fine, thank you.
Yes,
so, because it, as you know, microbiology is not easy.
Right.
I remember the first test we got back, 75 was the highest score.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, that's crazy.
So,
yeah.
But anyway, we got through that, and Sue Grindstaff, mother of Diane Thomas.
Oh yes.
She helped the nursing students get through chemistry. And we all appreciated her a lot.
I'm making little notes of other people that I can talk to, too, about that can tell about the history of the school.
Whenever I think of our chemistry class, I always think of how Dr. Cook approached it when we got into our rotation for chemistry and anesthesia. And so he would always address us by saying, this is chemistry for kumquats.
That's funny, yeah.
So we thought, oh good, it's not going to be too hard.
Yes. And that was Dr. Cook that said that, yes.
That's funny. Had a lot of fun saying
But he came and talked to us a couple times, I think right before he retired, when I was working in the helicopter, and he would give us little tips on how to intubate, how to bend the stylet in certain ways to make the tube do something at the end. And so I thought that was very interesting that he was, that he could. could do that. But anyway, yeah, so that's interesting. So that you heard from the nursing students about anesthesia, because to me, anesthesia is sort of hidden, and I didn't know about it until I was a nurse for a long time. I didn't know it was even really an option, and sometimes it still is kind of quiet. So I was curious how.
Well, actually, the first I knew about it was when I was in labor and delivery myself as a patient.
Yes, okay.
And the sweet young thing guy who came to do that part turned out to be a CRNA, or I think he was probably still a student. But I remember someone in the family said, "Oh my goodness, if you're ever interested in nursing, you ought to go into anesthesia. This young man told us all about it. It's a wonderful field. Did you know there were nurse anesthetists?"
Yeah.
So it came through one of the students himself
talking
about answering questions and being a good representative for the field.
Very cool. Good, good. Are you ever sorry you did it?
Not at all. It was a wonderful career. I wouldn't want to trade it for anything. I am very grateful I got to do it. And now I really appreciate everyone else who's doing it. And I love the way it's advanced. It's amazing how folks like you have been able to carry it through into a whole new social setting, a new professional level. The academic place, and I love the fact that Charlie and Mary Beth have helped with this wonderful building.
Yes.
So
we're so grateful for that.
Positive. Yeah.
Well, what other, just any memories that you have of like when you first started or being on call or what it was like when you went to school?
Yes. Well, it was very challenging. We had certain duties that students were supposed to do when they weren't doing cases in the afternoon and evening and through the night. And there was a pecking order, of course. We had a senior student and we had a junior student. And usually, when you say a senior student, it was someone who had been there almost the full 24 months. My senior student was an amazing, very competent young woman, a beautiful young woman, who actually had just been there 1 year, but she was so valued and trusted that she was put in charge with a younger student. So that was good. She was Rosalie Gwaltney. Yeah, very, very good. We did a lot of things by hand that our machines do now as far as the equipment being cleaned, etc. We repackaged a lot of things. The level of sterility that we now expect with our equipment, etc., was not the norm then. The results didn't seem to reflect any lapses in cleanliness or sanitation and all that, but it definitely represented a whole lot of manual labor that is not done today.
Because there wasn't automatic blood pressure cuffs, right? Did you have to?
Oh, that's our cuffs, yes. And that was a major challenge for everyone, being able to have your stethoscope and your blood pressure cuff. And we didn't have oximeters, of course, and so we always wanted to be able to see some part of the patient to assess color.
And the color of, what were you looking for?
Blue was not good. You know, you really wanted to be able to assess
nice
pupils
red.
For circulation. You also, I mean, people still kind of looked and for the conjunctivitis, see, are we still perfusing well? Are we all right with our blood, etc.? But yes, it was a whole lot more. You really you needed more arms and hands to keep track of all of the different parts of equipment that were not automated. And our machines didn't have near the fail-safe aspects that they have now. Like if your nitrous ran, let's see, if you would have oxygen and nitrous turned on,
uh-huh,
like for labor and delivery,
uh-huh,
to do a nitrous analgesia,
uh-huh,
uh-huh, etc.
Yeah.
And if your O2 tank emptied,
mm-hmm,
the nitrous did not go off.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow. Well, yeah. Yeah.
So we had hazards,
uh-huh,
that thankfully don't exist anymore.
Right. Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. So.
And so the ET tubes, tell us about, they were reusable. Is that right?
Yes. They were great big red rubber, strong things.
Uh-huh.
And you had bottle washers to,
uh-huh,
to go through them all.
Uh-huh.
And you really did scrub them and everything,
uh-huh,
and rinse them and,
uh-huh,
everything. But they were...
Yeah. Did they have balloons on them? Or
yes.
They did?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So you had to have your extra syringe to blow that up.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And that was a student duty to wash out the ET tubes for the day. And,
yeah.
And interesting. So what was your favorite kind of case to do?
Oh, gee. Favorite case? Well, you know, sometimes it boiled down to your favorite surgeon.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if I could say I had a favorite case, but you know, in spite of the fact that our labor and deliveries would all, you know, when you were on call at night,
mm-hmm,
those were the days before epidurals became the mode,
mm-hmm,
of choice,
uh-huh,
and it was very rare to have spinal or something,
uh-huh,
it's unusual.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
But many of the OBGYN guys liked to have nitrous analgesia.
Oh.
So you could be called at the discretion of the labor and delivery nurse when it was about time that it was okay, because,
uh-huh,
they didn't want to introduce that too early. They wanted the patient to be cooperative throughout
yes.
the labor.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but that was enjoyable in the sense that in those few moments and while the patient was relaxing between nitrous
mm-hmm.
and contractions, you related to the patient.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it was an opportunity to be of assistance and supportive during this very important time.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And usually labor and delivery ends well
uh-huh.
with everyone happy.
Yes.
And well.
Right. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, happy place.
Usually it's a very positive thing.
Right.
There are a few times when it is very sad, and we, of course, never forget those
right.
families.
Right.
But most, my memories of doing that, you know, I can see the OBGYN guys and know that, you know, they're doing a good thing for
mm-hmm.
these ladies,
mm-hmm.
and these ladies are doing their best
yes.
to be good patients,
right.
And it, to me, those are good memories.
Right.
Yeah, I enjoyed that.
Well, and so for the school, for those 2 years, did you have class every morning and then clinical all day? Like, and did it start right out as a call team spot? Like, for instance, when I went to school, we'd do like 16-hour overnights, and then you'd have a day off, and then you'd do an 8-hour, 10-hour, 12 or 16-hour. And every day class was at 6.
Yeah.
So how was the schedule when you sort of?
Well, you know, you had your 6 weeks or so with your mother.
Okay, yes.
So you were not on a call schedule yet.
Yeah.
And it was a rite of passage. It was oh goody, it's a milestone
if you got
put
off.
On.
Yes.
And then it was always a big deal. Well, whose call team are you on?
Yes.
You know, because
you stayed with them the whole time, didn't you?
Yes,
yeah.
I think that's pretty much it.
Uh-huh.
I'd have to think back.
Yeah.
You know, that call schedule, that was an amazing piece of work.
Yes.
And when people couldn't believe it that I could know 5 years from now
exactly.
what I'd be doing.
Yes.
Because they would all be waiting, even in the hospital. The
mm-hmm.
people would be waiting for, you know, I don't know, a month to month or a week to week of when I'm going to work and when I'll be off and
right.
how can I schedule this or that.
Yes.
It was like,
yes.
Oh, really?
Yes. yeah.
So,
yeah.
Carol, what?
Yes.
You?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
So, yes, we had the call schedule. It took us a few weeks to graduate to being on the call schedule. And then, of course, there'd be the pecking order of who got to do what when you were
at the cases,
call,
yes.
On
yes.
what the cases were.
Yeah.
And, you know, early on, we did a lot of cases without our anesthesiologists in the house.
Mm-hmm.
They knew what was happening. You know, the senior student would call them and say, we've got this, mm-hmm. and this is what the patient's like, and, you know, so there would be consultation and collaboration,
mm-hmm.
but most of the time, you would be doing the case.
And that was, so PAS ran anesthesia at Cox North and at Mercy? Is that?
Yes.
So they, okay.
Yes.
Yes, okay.
They knew what was happening
in
both places.
And so you would just be assigned today, Donna, go to Cox? Or come to?
Actually, you wouldn't know usually until the night before which hospital you were going to.
So they'd make assignments the night before.
They'd make assignments.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, okay.
And that was one of the students' duties, was to call everyone and say, this is your assignment.
Oh, where you're
going.
This
is where you're supposed to go.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
But you still had class at 6, no matter where you
yeah.
were. At Mercy or at
yes.
St. John's. Gotcha.
Right.
Okay. That's interesting. And then, so how did you have graduation? So it seems like odd time, like people would just come in every few months. Is that right?
That's right.
And then do you graduate every few months then
yes.
too?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Interesting.
But then, of course, they could only take the exam, the qualifying exam,
uh-huh.
certifying exam,
uh-huh.
whenever it was offered. So that was beyond our control. But
mm-hmm.
So if a person finished and was hired, they still couldn't practice until they got that certifying exam
results. Yes.
But yes, we came in ever at these intervals. What was it? 3, 6, 9, 12.
Every 3 months, okay.
So that's the case. We didn't come in once
all
a year.
Once, right. And it could be a couple people at a time, right? Or was it generally one person? It didn't matter. I just was
yes,
curious. So
right.
then it probably depends on who was graduating, so they would have the same number maybe.
Right.
Going
they
through.
Had to keep the call teams intact
mm-hmm.
and the total number intact.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll have to, Joyce would probably remember
that.
These. She
so
was with
yeah.
it before I was,
uh-huh.
and she would remember that.
Yeah. And then you worked at Mercy after you graduated? For
yes, mm-hmm. yes. Not long after this party,
uh-huh.
I got the good news that I would get to stay if I wanted to.
Uh-huh.
I had meanwhile been corresponding and talking with the people up, I started to say Truman, the Truman School of Anesthesia,
uh-huh.
Fairly new at that time.
Uh-huh.
And of course, we would look down on all those programs, just like St. Louis and Kansas City had always looked down on
us. Yeah.
We must be a lot better.
Yeah.
But anyway, they were looking for someone to help in their school and
uh-huh.
be on staff. So I remember Dr. Johnson had said, you've got to go, you've got to apply to that. So that was kind of on the list.
Uh-huh.
Plus, there was something happening in Portugal
uh-huh.
that I had seen this blurb about, and I had said, oh my goodness, and told my children, look what this is saying about this. What
uh-huh.
would that be like
yes.
if we moved over there for a while? And they all said, oh, we'd rather go to Hawaii. Anyway. When the opportunity came to stay, we were all very happy because that meant there'd be no change
for
the children in their
yes.
schools,
yes.
their friends,
yeah.
etc.
Yeah.
And
now, what years did you go to school? What year was it? You said April. So
April 1st. That would have been
April Fool's Day.
72.
Okay.
Because I had just my nursing was like from 70 to 72.
Okay.
I had started earlier with the tutoring thing.
Uh-huh.
You know,
uh-huh.
And then went on. I had to convince the sisters
uh-huh.
that it was okay for me to go to nurses training.
Oh, uh-huh.
But Sister Sharon was in charge of the School of Nursing at that time.
Hmm.
And once and during the tutoring of the CRNA students, I remember, or maybe they were just nursing students. But I remember telling Sister Sharon, you know, I've always been interested in medicine and nursing, and I wonder, you know, maybe someday I'd like the opportunity to study what I'm helping these people review, et cetera, et cetera. And so the ideas just kind of kept growing, and the door seemed open to ask at least. Well, the sister said, oh my goodness, you've already got this degree and that degree and that degree, you'd be way overtrained, you'd be bored. I said, oh, but my goodness, it's so different than, it's not the same kind of approach, you know.
Right, yeah.
Anyway, they said, no, we just don't think that it would be a good match for you. But I remember one day I was up in the chapel, and I was, you know, meditating, thinking about all these things, and looking into the future, listening, watching. And when I got up to leave, here was this whole row of nuns up there.
Wow.
And it wasn't long after I got, well, the sister decided if you really want to do it, I'll let you do it. So you can come on into nurses training. So I got into nurses training, and then from there went right on to anesthesia.
Now, was that when the building was there along National?
Yes.
So
a really nice, beautiful building.
Yes.
Dormitory. And we did lots of fun things there. We'd have programs. We'd have talent shows for, like, a Christmas program for the doctors to come in. The nursing school was quite fun. As I mentioned, Sister Sharon, this young nun, she was like Maria. But she made school, you know, she brought the tradition of the Sisters of Mercy up to the generation that many of the students were in. We were the first group that could enter already married.
I was going to ask you about that, because I know Tracy Beckham's mother got in trouble and dismissed from school because she was married. So, so you were the first group that could be married.
Yes. Before us, there had been some leeway that at your senior year, they would give you permission to marry. But we were the first ones who could come in married, and a couple of us had children. And then some got expecting during the course, and instead of the sisters being disappointed, they said, that's wonderful, new life.
Good,
I mean, really,
good.
They truly reflected this principle of life is
that was a change.
It wasn't like, oh, you're gonna mess up this schedule. But it was like, oh, that's wonderful. We can do whatever it takes to help you finish school and get the baby here happy. And I mean, it was like, oh, what a relief.
Nice.
You know.
Good. Yeah. I still remember that building too. I went to nursing school there also.
Yes.
And but they imploded it right after I graduated.
Yes.
And so it was, I watched them do that. And it was all that beautiful marble.
Yes.
And the library was at the end. And
That was traumatic.
Yes.
It just like tearing down the front of St. John's with the steps going up.
Yes.
And like, it was like a sacred space almost.
Right.
But anyways.
Yes. Gone.
Beautiful now.
Yes, it is beautiful. But was Dr. Tillman in charge of the school, or Dr. Wise at that
Dr.
time?
Dr. Wise. Was
and Bill was like his second in command. Is that how?
Yes.
Dr. Wise was the medical director, and then Bill was.
Yes. Good
okay.
point.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Right.
Okay. Got that. And well. Anything else that you can think of to tell us or that would be helpful? I'm trying to put like a timeline together, sort of how, like from when it started, you know, in 1952.
Yes.
And then how they took students, which that's so interesting to me that you just they said, come on in and start. And I think they still, even Tracy Beckham says it was kind of like that, you know, just come on, let's start. And then you ran everything and you washed, and we have a couple of those rubber ET tubes that got washed, and that's just amazing. And actually, Rick, you know, Abal is here. I can't wait for him.
Right.
He's teaching a class right now,
yes.
So for him to see this. Yeah. And if there also is someone else that you can think of that would be helpful with, you know, telling us about it, it's just important to remember our history, feel like. Because we have come a long way and we're amazing, but the history is amazing.
Yes,
and
so, it is. I think one of the interesting things is that when Dr. Crawford would talk about starting when he talked later to us mm-hmm. about having started the school, mm-hmm. it was like anesthesia specialty for doctors was very unusual.
Uh-huh.
And most of when they came, you know, the pediatricians were doing the anesthesia for kids or some of the generalists mm-hmm. were doing anesthesia,
uh-huh.
but it was rare for them to have someone who was trained as an anesthesiologist.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So when he came, that was a really big deal,
uh-huh.
and he was highly respected,
uh-huh.
and he performed in a way that they all continued to mm-hmm. have that for him.
Mm-hmm.
And then I guess Dr. Tillman got to be like, I don't want to say the word wouldn't be apprentice,
mm-hmm.
but preceptor.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
So one physician would work with another physician and learn that specialty.
Uh-huh,
okay. So he was like, that's how Dr. Tillman got into being a real anesthesiologist,
gotcha.
As I understand it,
uh-huh,
as
uh-huh.
I remember it.
Uh-huh.
So those were important administrative factors and historical factors.
Uh-huh.
But as far as the reason they wanted the school, they needed more help.
Yeah.
They needed more help. And they felt like, well, and they handpicked those nurses you see on the board.
Mm-hmm.
These are people we watched. We know that they tend to every detail.
Mm-hmm.
We know that they take good care of patients, that they interact well with doctors, that mm-hmm. they follow orders well.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And so they handpicked those people
uh-huh.
to be their first class. They thought if we can train, these be extenders. These
right.
will be, we can oversee what they do,
mm-hmm.
but we can show them what to do, and they can develop into
mm-hmm.
nurses that
can do
anesthesia.
Right. Uh-huh.
And it was all very positive because
uh-huh.
the nurses were helping the doctors
uh-huh.
and everyone was, that was good.
Happy. Yeah. Yeah.
And then, you know, it grew out from that.
Yes.
They had more students. They had
uh-huh.
more patients,
uh-huh.
more work to do.
Yeah.
And then they would get more anesthesiologists.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it grew up. But it
yeah.
grew out of a necessity.
Mm-hmm.
It always reminded me of the Mayo doctors and how the reason they had to train the nurses or sisters to do the anesthesia is because all the doctors wanted to watch the surgeons. You know,
yes.
there was no one to tend
yeah.
the patient. It
yeah.
was like, we need someone
just
to tend the
patient. Yeah.
So there were the nuns who became the anesthesia people.
Yeah.
So I guess that's true of most professions, and medicine especially, is
mm-hmm.
what you need, that's
yeah.
the way you train your
people. Yeah. Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. And the nice part, I think, about St. John's, too, was always the sisters. You could
yes.
see them around the hospital. And
yes.
I remember, too, St. Pius, you know, when
yes.
that was a floor.
Yes.
And I'll tell you a quick story about me in nursing school. I was class president. And so on St. Patrick's Day, we were assigned to St. Pius for evening shift. And so I got together with my group, my team, seven of us, and we wore green pants. And we put our ponytails at the top of our hat. We still had to wear the hats. And we got in big trouble because
oh,
that was, you wore your
yes.
uniforms and your hats in
yes.
those days and in the middle.
Yes.
But the patients loved it.
Of course.
They loved it. On St. Pius, we were doing the 6-bottle routine, you know,
yes.
watching the color of the urine.
Yes.
And down the hall came Norma Boone and what was the other lady's name that was in charge of the school then and sent us all home.
Oh,
so,
shoot.
But anyway, that was,
well, we've come a long way.
Yes.
Everything had to be very regimented in those
yes.
days.
Yes.
And, you know, I guess whatever that strictness of the sisters was always balanced with your trust of their higher allegiance.
Yes. Yeah.
They ran very tight floors.
Yeah. Yes.
And they were sticklers for cleanliness and for minding the orders. That was all true. But then they had this softer side.
Right. Yeah.
And I miss that very much.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Sister Mary Richard, actually, I don't know if you knew her. I worked for a veterinarian in Springfield for a while, and she would always come there and bring leftover bedpans or things from Mercy, from St. John's, that they didn't need anymore, so we could use it at the veterinary hospital.
Yeah.
And even our the veterinary doctor, C.C. Moore, was like my dad.
Oh.
And he gave the Sisters of Mercy a car so they could drive around in it.
Yes.
And they used it up and gave it back to him. And it was the old Delta 88. And I'll never forget, I was 16, and he said, "Do you want that old car?" And I was ecstatic.
Of course.
It was like a tank, and I could have an actual car. And so, but that was it had belonged to the Sisters of Mercy first so that they could use it. But
oh, anyways, what a fun connection.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah. But, and I'll, you know, if you think of something else, you know, that you think would be important, and when I start writing, I'll send it to you and let you read it, and feel free to edit it, you know, because it's history.
That'll probably jog my memory a lot.
Sure, and it's history according to how we remember it, you know, and history is written by the people that write it down. And so if we don't have it right, it's not intended to be... it's only for memories, you know, and because I want these young guys out here to know about it and to be appreciative of what we've come from, you know, and so that they know.
And go on.
Yeah, so, and make it better. So
exactly. That's good, hon. That'll be good.
So.
And since we all came in at different points on the calendar and at different stages of the school's development and at different stages of our own professional
development,
then each of our histories is unique.
Right.
But if, when you get a cross-country, cross-section of them, then that's going to be much more truthful.
Right. And I look forward to talking to Bill. Like I said, I've talked to him on the phone a few times.
Good.
But I want to get some more, if I can go pick him up maybe or something, or have Bert. Talk to Bert or to Rick, you know, and have them go.
That would be good.
And then maybe at our reunion that we'll have in March, is it March 31st, I think?
Yeah.
Maybe some more people will want to tell stories or talk about it or write me a story.
Right.
Because we all like to read the stories, too, you know.
Yes.
And so I think that'd be nice.
That
and it's not
good.
About, it won't be making any money or anything like that. It's just about our history. And so
that's kind of important.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much again. This is Donna Murney, and we appreciate her coming to the O'Reilly Health Sciences Building on November 9th, 2016 for the oral history of the school. And here is a certificate of her training. And St. John's Hospital, Springfield, Missouri, Donna Lambert Runge. Is that right? Certificate of training. And then when you took the exam, they, and here is the American Association of Nurse Anesthetists, and she became a certified registered nurse anesthetist in September 1973. And her membership number is 22152. That's amazing. That's amazing.
And
that
we had to be able to dress up for that first Christmas party, so that was the best I could do that day.
That's amazing. Now, do you have any pictures of your class or the other students? And because I'm wanting to put on the wall, that big white wall, pictures of classes as we have them. Like, I have that first class, the three of them, but I don't, there's a big gap in between that I don't have.
Right.
And so
we did have some
That
were left in the department. I don't know if we can ever trace down where everything was stored.
Yes.
And went, but yes, we did. Whoops, we did.
If you, you want to keep one of
that
those.
That was part of the Christmas program.
Oh, okay.
That everyone, and also, I think Bill took pictures of the classes.
He took lots of pictures. I mean, he liked taking pictures. And I have some photo albums, a bunch of them back there. to go through. And I also don't want them to get, the pictures are turning brown.
Right.
And I don't know what, I have to learn or find what you do with those, because I don't want them to, you know, get lost. And I don't know some of the people in there.
Right.
And so Rick knew some of them. He was helpful. Yeah. And so, but anyway, it's kind of amazing. It's amazing. And thank you for taking time to do this.
Oh, you're welcome.
I appreciate it.